Many space startups are involved in the Artemis program, the NASA-led project comprising over 60 countries that plans to return to the moon and stay there. The purpose is to do so in a sustainable way, slowly building a thriving lunar economy. DARPA recently published a field guide that envisions a thriving lunar economy by the mid-2030s and explores the steps needed to make it happen. I've already published a video on lunar power from this field guide, and today I'm covering a topic that not many people think of, but is vitally important: thermal management. On the Earth, this is not a big problem, due to the atmosphere moderating temperature differences between the illuminated and dark sides of the planet. On the Moon, that lacks an atmosphere, there is no convection method of transferring heat. The lunar day is over 120 degrees Celsius, while the lunar night plunges to below minus 170 degrees Celsius. Every piece of lunar infrastructure on the Moon, from habitation modules, power systems, and rovers, must deal with these extreme temperature swings or either melt or freeze. For instance, in the lunar night, battery electrolytes freeze, resulting in dead lunar landers or rovers. One service that space startups could offer is thermal management. So, let's look at that now, using the DARPA field guide as a reference for this topic. Thermal management. According to the guide, a large fraction of every payload landed on the lunar surface is designed to deal with thermal management. These systems comprise of radiators, pumps, coolant fluids, pipes, and the electrical systems and software to control them. To put some numbers on how much mass is required to handle the lunar environment, approximately 60% of an optical power beaming system is a thermal system by mass. For lunar resource processing, or ISRU for short, it's around 45%. For a nuclear reactor, it's around 25%. And for a fuel cell system, it's approximately 45%. As you can see, a large amount of mass of every piece of hardware landed on the moon is to stop the equipment from melting. So far, Artemis missions don't operate during the lunar night, but that will likely change soon, as both iSpace and Intuitive Machines are planning lunar night survival. Building out lunar infrastructure would be easier if the thermal management problem could be separated out and provided as a service. We'll explore that concept next. Thermal hub concept. A thermal hub provides a service where multiple customers can connect their equipment and receive heating or cooling as required, in either active or passive modes. This concept is called thermal management as a service. It would be valuable as every space startup, space agency, or private company that wants to operate on the moon must handle thermal loads to prevent equipment failure. Thermal management as a service reduces payload mass and complexity. Instead of each lunar operator having to design, develop, test, verify, and operate their own custom solution, they can rely on an already existing solution on the moon already. Think of this concept as an efficient local thermal microgrid, available under commercial terms for every lunar operator. In many ways, it's similar to central air conditioning in an apartment building. By aggregating many different users with heating and cooling demands, the hub can efficiently move thermal loads where needed, dumping excess heat in thermal batteries or starting processes to generate extra heat as required by lunar customers. This centralized thermal management system reduces electricity demands and provides reliable 24/7 management to keep all equipment operating at optimum temperatures. Introducing the Lunar Oasis. The field guide uses a modification of the Lunar Saber mast from Honeybee Robotics to illustrate a possible thermal management solution. If you are not familiar with this lunar infrastructure, check out my video on their versatile lunar mast solution. This graphic shows the mast, which could be up to 100 meters in height, converted into a thermal hub. From the graphic, we can see how the mast is stowed for transport, deployed, expanded to its full height, with an extended MLI tent added, and finally other lunar infrastructure is connected to benefit from the thermal management. MLI stands for multi-layer insulation. It's a common way of providing passive thermal control in space. The material is lightweight and consists of multiple layers of material separated by gaps to stop heat transfer. Similar to how double glazed windows stop heat escaping from a house, the MLI layers stop radiative heat loss or gain, helping to keep the interior volume at a steady temperature. Thermal architecture. The Lunar Oasis mask contains a complete thermal management solution consisting of pumps, valves, connectors, radiators, and a deployable MLI tent. Let's look at the seven elements needed to make this system work. Thermal core. At the center of the Lunar Oasis is a system that actively transports heat between different elements. This core consists of a two-phase pumped fluid loop. The two heat loops serve both low-temperature power sources like electronics and high-temperature sources such as a nuclear reactor, metal foundries, and regolith processing systems. Radiators. Excess heat is radiated to space by large radiators deployed from the Lunar Oasis mast. The mast rotates to track the sun, and the radiators are mounted at a 90-degree angle to avoid direct solar heating. Each radiator panel helps dump excess thermal heat into space and can reject approximately 630 watts per square meter of heat. Radiators are needed to keep the equipment within operating temperatures during the lunar day. Let's look at a potential tiered service that could be offered to lunar operators. Premium plan, active cooling. Heat is pumped to and from high power density users. Lunar operators using this service are directly plugged into the fluid loop using dust-tolerant connectors. Standard plan, passive cooling. Mobile or low-power users have access to a clamp-on heat plate to provide additional heating in addition to the MLI tent. These clamp-on hot plates are a good option for mobile equipment such as lunar rovers. Basic plan, MLI tent. A large deployable tent, or possibly a collection of smaller tents, around the base of the mast provides a daytime sunshade and nighttime warmth to mobile or stationary users. If this proves insufficient thermal control, users can always upgrade to passive or active cooling plans. Lithium-ion battery storage. Thermal hubs store or dump excess heat into batteries for nighttime heating. For the lunar South Pole, nighttime lasts only 2 days at most, so only modest battery storage is needed. At the equator, it's a completely different story, with nighttime lasting 14 days. Radioactive heat source, optional. Radioactive heaters or nuclear batteries can be added for additional continuous thermal heating. These are simple and passive systems that generate a small but consistent amount of heating. In addition, RTGs, or radioisotope thermoelectric generators, provide a small amount of electricity. For commercial services, only Xenopower provides nuclear batteries suitable for the moon. At least this is the only company I am aware of. Why thermal management as a service makes sense? Consolidating thermal management into one or more central thermal hubs reduces the amount of mass on the moon by a vast amount. As stated earlier, approximately half of the total mass of payloads are thermal management systems. Some operators, especially those involved in laser sintering for lunar roads or landing pads, power beaming or mining operations, generate large amounts of thermal heat that needs to be removed to stay within operating temperatures. All lunar equipment must be able to dissipate peak thermal loads, otherwise the equipment melts. This means for normal operations, their thermal management system is oversized. A consolidated thermal system reduces landed mass by a staggering 80%, according to the report. This assumes thermal needs are not in phase with each other. That is, operators' heating and cooling needs are not correlated with each other. This graph is a simplified version of the graph in the field study, which is linked to in the video description. Consolidating thermal management massively reduces mass needed to be transported to the moon. A consolidated thermal hub can more efficiently radiate heat away compared to a small, compact lunar lander or rover. Lunar mass can be up to 100 meters in height, with enough radiators attached to radiate 30 kilowatts of thermal heat into space. There is practically no size limit to the deployable radiators on these large masts. The radiators found on rovers and landers are limited by the size of the equipment, and the horizontal configuration has much lower efficiency in radiating heat. Waste heat from certain operators, such as processing or power beaming, can be captured and redistributed to habitation modules or other equipment needing heating. This is a similar concept to combined heat and power systems on Earth. This reduces the size and capacity of power systems further, reducing the amount of mass needed to be transported to the moon. Heat pumps can even be made to transport heat against the thermal gradient, allowing, for example, boosting fluid temperature for local regolith processing operations. The field study shares a surprising insight from the Lunar 10 architecture study. A shared radioactive heat source reduces battery mass by an order of magnitude, that's 10 times, at the pole, and two orders of magnitude, or 100 times, at the equator, demonstrating that nuclear batteries are an extremely useful and simple power system for the moon. This is because a single nuclear battery can share its heat across many users, greatly reducing the need for battery mass. A network of thermal hubs across the lunar surface provides safe shelter for lunar rovers. When the sun sets, the rovers can shelter at the nearest thermal hub to prevent systems from freezing and resume operations when the sun rises. Thermal hubs complement power microgrids. It's likely for a lunar economy, power microgrids will be needed to be established. See my previous video on lunar power for more about lunar power grids. The reason a thermal hub integrates well with a power grid is because power systems and high voltage conversion systems necessary for a power grid generate large amounts of excess heat. Instead of dumping the heat offboard and wasting it, a thermal hub captures the heat and either stores it or transports it to paying customers. Using lunar soil as a thermal battery, insulated tanks of regolith placed near thermal hubs and connected with pumped fluid loops can be used as thermal batteries. The material properties of lunar soil or regolith make it suitable for storing thermal heat. Something as simple as solar concentrators that focus the sun's energy onto the tank would be enough to heat the regolith over the lunar day. Alternatively, waste heat from other lunar operations could also be used. Excavators are used to fill tanks with regolith. Since this type of regolith moving equipment is necessary for mining tasks, so will be available on the moon's surface once ISRU operations are underway. During the lunar day, when excess energy is available, the regolith tank is heated. At night, thermal heat is extracted from the regolith tank using a pumped fluid loop. The heated fluid returns to the thermal hub and can be used to warm up equipment or for space heating in habitation modules. Previous NASA studies have confirmed regolith tanks retain enough heat for nighttime use. Mathematical models predict high thermal losses of 44% to the surrounding cold soil. Still, core temperatures above 1000 degrees Celsius are possible over the lunar night. Many factors affect this, so some experimentation and tech development are needed. For instance, sintering or melting the regolith improves performance, and different coolant fluids could also improve performance. It's an area worth studying, as large-scale thermal batteries would be useful near the South Pole and essential near the equator, where the lunar night can last for 14 days. As an example from Earth, let's look at the world's largest sand battery in Finland. This gives you an idea of what a thermal battery on the moon would look like, although it would use lunar soil rather than sand. This thermal battery could store 100 megawatt hours of thermal heat with a 90% round trip efficiency. It's likely that for the moon, at least the first iteration of a thermal battery would have a much lower efficiency. This sand battery uses a closed loop air pipe system rather than a liquid with air temperatures exceeding 600 degrees Celsius. Final thoughts. Lunar Oasis is a practical and scalable thermal hub concept to consolidate thermal management operations for lunar operators. By aggregating thermal management to one or more thermal hubs, massive savings in mass to the moon are possible. Excess heat from operations that would normally be dumped into space can be captured and redistributed to paying customers or stored for later use. A thermal management service is a good idea for lunar space startups to work on, as every lunar operator will need thermal management, and an aggregated service is cheaper to operate than a custom solution. Thermal hubs are critical pieces of lunar infrastructure for an emerging lunar economy, allowing less massive and therefore cheaper payloads to be transported to the moon with thermal management available offboard. In the same way, power could be offboard by setting up a lunar power grid. What do you think of the idea of thermal management as a service? Is the lunar mass concept a good design, or can you think of better approaches? Leave your thoughts and opinions in the comments section below. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this space video, consider buying me a coffee to help fund more episodes like this. The link is in the description. Space News Live is on Saturday evening or Sunday morning, depending where you watch from. The live stream is a great way for you to share your thoughts and opinions on the videos I posted this week, or on any space topic in general. I highlight the most thought-provoking comments on videos I've received, along with previews of upcoming content. If you've got the time, please tune in and say hi. Be sure to like and subscribe so you'll see our upcoming videos. We make videos every week covering the space industry, with an emphasis on the smaller space startups that aren't covered so well on other channels. See you soon.